what is it that you do as a company? What is the service that you provide to businesses and people?
Yeah, you know, at the end of the day, I really have simplified all that we do, and I connect and I protect. And, you know, connection is everything. Connection is everything in the brewery world, in the restaurant world, in the hospitality world in general. It's all about us connecting with the people and us connecting with our vendors and us connecting with other establishments. And that's I'm a huge advocate of that. And having owned 12, 13 restaurants myself, I understand that side of the business very well. And then, you know, it's also connecting with the different associations like the Guild and the Restaurant Association. And, you know, I mean, the week after this wonderful festival, we have Devour. And that's going to be, you know, amazing as well.
Arizona is a wildly beautiful place, brimming with over 100 brewing companies. I'm Rob Fulmer, the Executive Director of the Arizona Craft Brewers Guild. I'm joined by Deputy Director Andrew Bauman. Together we cover the state, bringing you the best of what's happening at our breweries and beyond. Welcome to Arizona Beer Frontier.
What iPhone do you
have? It's not an iPhone. It's a Pixel 7.
Oh, okay. Yeah, this camera on this thing is pretty sick.
So did you have a pretty good Valentine's Day? Did you do anything?
No, we didn't do anything.
Oh, you gotta talk up.
We didn't do anything. Oh, we're on. Hold on.
No. We're not on. Oh. I'm just trying to get
having a conversation. No, Valentine's Day was it was rather uneventful, both mentally and physically.
Well, it was statehood day.
It was statehood day.
Yeah. So happy 1-1-1 to Arizona.
And it was cold.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's cold today. It's sunny, but, by all accounts, the weather's going to be 76 and partly cloudy.
Is that what we're looking at?
Yeah.
I'm going to update the weather here. Let's look.
Usually when I do this show, Andrew's here and, for some reason, I'm Hey Rob and he's Andrew Bauman. Cause like, it's like, Hey Rob, Andrew Bauman. So you're just D-Lo.
I'm just the D-Lo. Yeah. You're right. Saturday, we are looking at a forecast of 45 degrees low and 74 high.
Yeah. Nice.
So that's going to be a beautiful day. And actually that is the best day. If you look on here, that is literally the best day for the next 7 days.
Yeah. Well, we used to put a bit in early for good weather and so far so good.
So far so good. No rain insurance needed.
So D-Lo, David DeLorenzo, the D-Lo.
Yes, sir.
What brings you to the office today?
I am a proud sponsor. I am a proud, let's just say, advocate of local business and the breweries. And I decided to come and deliver a bunch of my banners, which you so graciously are going to put up in the VIP area for me.
Yeah, right on. So David DeLorenzo, Ambassador Insurance, Bar and Restaurant Insurance is the brand, right?
That is correct.
He had a relationship with the Brewers Guild for a number of years. This, by the way, I've never had to say this, even though he's got a Bar and Restaurant Insurance mug with his name on it that we have had on the show here and there. This is not a paid promotional.
No.
You just happened to meet me here to drop off those banners, and I'm like, hey, do you got 20 minutes? Because Andrew's not around. We're running around. This is the Wednesday before Strong Beer Festival, and I wasn't sure if we were going to put together a show or not. I might have Andrew on at the back end if he stops by today, but this is usually when we upload our video and all that stuff, but I'm not saying you're filling in. I've been wanting to sit down and talk to you for a while, and it won't be the last time.
Well,
so what is it that you do as a company? What is the service that you provide to businesses and people?
Yeah, you know, at the end of the day, I really have simplified all that we do, and I connect and I protect. And, you know, connection is everything. Connection is everything in the brewery world, in the restaurant world, in the hospitality world in general. It's all about us connecting with the people and us connecting with our vendors and us connecting with other establishments. And that's I'm a huge advocate of that. And having owned 12, 13 restaurants myself, I understand that side of the business very well. And then, you know, it's also connecting with the different associations like the Guild and the Restaurant Association. And, you know, I mean, the week after this wonderful festival, we have Devour. And that's going to be, you know, amazing as well. So it's about connecting with all the parties, you know, to be that throw these amazing events and have amazing local vendors come in. And then the people come and they learn more about, you know, the old places, the new places, what's in their neighborhood and all that. And then the other aspect of what I do, yes, it's protect. It's a little bit more of the, let's just say, boring aspect of things because, well, it's not boring until something happens. So until a drunk driver, you know, hits somebody, or until somebody gets beat up, or let's just say a vat of beer blows up, or, you know, somebody slips and falls, it's just not that interesting and people have to pay for it anyway. So that's what I do.
Right on. And it's not always bad. I mean, it's just, I think what I found over the years is when I know, how things work. It's very comforting.
Yeah.
I will tell you though, I've limited my understanding of how this works. Just enough to get things done. And then every once in a while I can add on a piece. But, the nice thing about it is I know I can pick up the phone. I can talk to you. I know I can talk to Kristen. Over at your office and get some answers. And sometimes, a lot of times I'm trying to get answers for things we might do and may not do. So it guides our process a lot. Sometimes I ask things that have to do with breweries. And then because I know I anticipate what they might do next, I will ask somewhat of a hypothetical. Obviously, if you hear anything about insurance from me directly, you should contact your own agent. It's just to fill your head with the possibility and the questions to ask, because that's all I want to do on my end.
Yeah. And you make a really good point. I mean, at the end of the day, it's something that you have to have, whether it be because you want to as a business to protect yourself per your lease, you know, all these assets that you've put together, and it's a peace of mind. It really is. And there's a lot of questions and a lot of ideas that get, you know, thrown at me that sometimes just aren't the best option. But again, as somebody that's creative in hospitality, sometimes your mind's not thinking about the possible risk or what goes on. You're thinking about, this is a great idea. We want to do tattoos while everybody's getting drunk, you know, at our place. And
we might be doing that.
That's a real thing that happens. And so it's just up to me to, you know, be the messenger and go back to the actual people that hold the contracts with you and find out if that's going to be something that they're willing to pay on. God forbid something happens. You know, it's always about trial and error, asking questions. The amount of claims that I've seen in, you know, 23 years of doing this, I would say I have quite a bit of experience, but I don't have it all.
Sure, sure. I think we might be doing henna tattoos, but that's another.
No, that's another. Yeah. So we're good.
So what we had Camila Alarcon, our general counsel, and, you know, kind of the theme of, like, you know, it's time to, you know, find the right people, talk to the right people, hire the right people, and you're in that definition, simply because, again. You know, it's easy to sign stuff. It's easy to pay for stuff. Right. Not easy to get what you want sometimes when it's difficult to understand, you know, conceptually what you got going on. But what I tell people is you have to have a relationship with these kinds of companies, because if, let's just say, you sign a policy and you don't know the agent and you don't know the company or anything about it, and you're scrambling to find the phone number, and you're trying to find your policy, and you're trying to read it while you're on the phone. What I tell people is you have to have a relationship. They have to know your story, so that when you get on the phone with them, in your case, it's just one call, they already know your story. They already know what you're trying to do. They already have seen things. I invite you to our events. You want to come to our events,
right?
So you know what it's all about, and you know, you're one of the secret team of people I ask, well, how did you think it went from, you know, a safety perspective or whatever? I'm going to get that feedback. That's the important thing. And I think that you do that well.
No, I appreciate that. Thank you. I mean, look, at the end of the day, I have a passion for life. I have a passion for what I do, but I have mainly a passion for people. And this is, you know, this is a people world that we live in. So when, you know, somebody is looked at as a commodity or just something that is just, you know, thrown at you, it's like, what use is that? And for me, it's very important to understand the industry. It's very important to understand what goes on in the industry, not just from an insurance perspective. Yes, of course, I want to be the most knowledgeable in that. And I do a lot of studying and training, but from a hospitality aspect of knowing, you know, who, what, when, where, what's going on in your business, how does it operate, what are you doing in the background, and going and being present and listening to, you know, the owner's stories and how they got there and what they're doing. All of that stuff is just very, very important. And to know that I'm reachable and able to discuss what is or is not included in your policy based on the underwriting language. I've seen policies without liquor liability. I've seen policies with gun exclusions, weapons exclusions. Look, just because you're a brewery or maybe a low-key sort of place or you think you are, doesn't mean that somebody, you know, God forbid, can't get shot in your parking lot or inside. We live in a crazy world right now. So it's just these little things that I see day in and day out that I want to make sure are not a part of my, you know, book of business.
Right on. Listen, I don't want to, we're going to make insurance sexy, but I want to have our listeners understand. We're going to talk about a few other things besides insurance. And one of them is, first of all, we just sat down to talk. I had a question. We could have done it over email, but I knew you were coming. So we talked for 5 minutes and I just noticed my email came up and I got the certificate I need from Kristen. So look at that.
Like, kudos to Kristen.
While you wait.
I see that.
Service That's while awesome. You wait. but you started in a different industry altogether.
That's correct. The music business. I worked for Warner Brothers. I worked for Van Halen, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Madonna. I mean, just to name a few, these are all people that I met and I actually had a working relationship with briefly, but I did.
Right on. Yeah. And what was that like?
Oh, man. It was, as a 20-something-year-old kid, it was one of these things where I wasn't sure what was going on. It was kind of a blur. And I was so fixated on becoming like the next biggest record exec. And I was going to do this and that. And all my dreams were pretty much squashed and pulled away from me. Once Apple came out with iTunes and the record labels weren't doing the same sort of jobs that they were doing before. And my only options were to go live in the cold, which is not going to happen because I'm freezing today in Arizona. Or it was to go do insurance. And that to me was crazy as well. And that's why I had to, you know, create a niche in what I loved. And that was the hospitality aspect of stuff.
Sure. And you carry some of that rock and roll attitude with you. You've developed personality to explain your brand. You've got a podcast show. You do videos. You work with, you tell me who you're working with, different agencies, different restaurants.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean,
who are the rock stars? Who are the Van Halens of that world?
You know, the Van Halens are the Oso, Angry Crabs, the Pita Jungles. I have pretty much all of Old Town Scottsdale with Whiskey Row and El Jefe, a lot of different, you know, just really cool types of, you know, risk all over there, you know, from breweries to nightclubs to press coffee to you name it. And, you know, at the end of the day, what I have is a commodity, but it's like you said, it's a personality thing. It's about being relevant. I'm active on all the social media platforms. I love podcasting because I love hearing other people's stories and dragging out of them other questions and other things that I think people would be interested in, you know, to hear. And, again, relevance to me is key and not being in the shadows.
Yeah. Yeah. So who's your favorite, like, restaurant personality these days?
Restaurant personality.
Yeah, I mean, who really sells their brand, you know, and obviously we have a lot of people who do things at a high level in the restaurants out here, but
Yeah, I mean, locally in Arizona, there's a lot of great branding. I will say, you know, not a client, but I love what they do, and I love going to your events and seeing their setup as Huss.
Oh, yeah.
It's just incredible marketing and branding and putting all that together and a lot of respect.
You told me they're going to be on your show. What's your show all about? How do they find out about that?
Yeah, so On the Delo is the podcast, and it's just basically, you know, you can get it on Spotify, Apple, all those sorts of things, but, you know, I've been doing it for over 2 years. Podcasts do not survive after a few episodes because of the consistency and effort and all. I had you on like over a year and a half ago.
I know. I think this is episode 37 for us, and we've maintained mostly a weekly. I mean, we haven't missed a week.
Yeah.
We're late today, but
no, I hear you. So, you know, that for me, the podcast is because I enjoy it and because I love having people into my office and I love just chatting. And so you and I could have this conversation without anybody else listening, and it would be the same conversation as if everybody's listening.
I get that a lot. So when we met, I think we met in the context of an Arizona Licensed Beverage Association meeting. Or this is where I knew that there was a lot more to what you do and what your interests lie and going above and beyond. There was a point when it was difficult to get liquor liability insurance for number 6 licenses. Those are the straight up bars where you can get spirits. Yep. and there's not necessarily food. So think about your dive bars, your nightclubs, that kind of thing. A couple of major insurers were either pulling out or talking about pulling out. Well, you set up that scene, and I'll ask the next question.
Yeah. So a lot of times, you know, a lot of people go get number 6 and they'll ask me, you know, why are the rates so high for this or that? And I'm like, well, it's because you're pretty much 100% liquor. You know, you're a nightclub, you're a dive bar, you're that sort of thing. And, you know, the reasoning for that, Arizona has some of the worst liquor laws, you know, when it comes to protecting the establishment. I mean, that's just the way it is. And Title IV ingrained in our Arizona Constitution, you know, back in the 80s, they had created this, you know, this definition of if you serve somebody, quote unquote, you know, knowingly intoxicated. And you just think about how broad that is and what that means. Really what it means in simplistic terms is if somebody leaves your bar and the police are able to, you know, have them breathalyze at 0.08, the bar or establishment can be held liable. And it's just crazy, you know, the way that it is. Now, maybe, you know, their amount of liability is only a certain percentage. Maybe it's a bigger percentage, maybe this or that. But at the end of the day, a claim gets filed on insurance. The insurance company then pays defense costs at whatever these attorneys cost, you know, however many hundreds an hour. And then that claim sits on your record as either an open liquor claim or one that was closed for, and they generally will settle because nobody wants to go to trial defending a bar, nightclub, restaurant, you know, against a jury of sympathetic people after, you know, somebody got killed, you know, on the freeway. It's just, so yes, you and I met at one of these meetings. I'm the only insurance representative in the midst of attorneys and, you know, guild, you know, president or executive, you know, directors and, you know, directors of the restaurant association. And the reason why I am there is because I want to protect my clients more in the aspect of making sure that if and when a claim is filed, that they can get off of it quicker.
Yeah, yeah. Well, so interestingly enough, some states have a limit on a dollar amount. Is it?
Yeah,
dollar
they
amount?
Have a limit. Cap on their limit. Right.
Here, we do not. It would take it would take a constitutional amendment.
Correct.
To do so, which yep. is, I'm just going to guess, is like 2/3 of the full body of the legislature to sign off on it. It's a difficult bar, no pun, but it's being resisted by, I'm just going to say, maybe the folks who can afford to do a Super Bowl commercial, those Correct. Types of lawyers.
Plaintiff attorneys? Yeah.
Yeah. So is that crisis passed somewhat, or are we still kind of in this zone where bad things could happen if one company literally says we're going to pull our stakes up?
Yeah, we're still in the zone of in Arizona, you know, there's still there's still not a cap on limits. There's still not really any resolution as far as, you know, there have been some moves to make it a little bit more difficult to sue. But at the end of the day, because the laws have been pretty much the same for decades, there's going to be a trial and error period to find out, you know, how this stuff, you know, gets litigated, because nothing's really been litigated yet on that. So it's really just a moving target and an ever so changing battle. I will say there has been a new carrier that has given me some exclusive rights, and I do have some breweries with this carrier that has been really good about fighting claims. They have attorneys on staff. You know, they came into this state understanding how the laws were not going to be beneficial to them, but they came in with the mindset of being able to educate and create more value for the client so that they can, you know, they can take care of them on the back end if and when something happens. But, you know, as far as a resolution of just, you know, dirt cheap bottom rates like Vegas, who doesn't have any dram shop, I just don't see that happening.
Dram shop refers to that level of liability.
Yeah.
So I'm going to make an analogy. You can tell me if it's close enough.
Yeah.
We're kind of in that, hey, well, you know, no one really notices the supply chain till a ship goes sideways in the Suez, or, you know what I'm talking about?
Yep.
All of a sudden we're out of toilet paper. It could be kind of like that, right? I mean, like, there could be a major claim. Somebody pulls their stakes.
Yeah.
In the news today, we're seeing a bunch of, like, rail wrecks right now.
Yeah.
I can imagine in their insurance world, people are probably having lots of meetings and figuring out like how they can adjust. So is it fair to say that we're kind of in that position right now?
We've been in that position for, I mean, since I've been doing insurance 20 years, you know, 20 plus years. And so I can name off a list of insurance, you know, carriers, again, supply, demand, or right, wanting to do, you know, risk aversion, that have come and gone, you know, and that we're here for, you know, I mean, Badger Mutual, that's a big one. I know a lot of people that are familiar with insurance or pay those bills. They're probably familiar with that company going, God, what happened to them? They were so cheap. They were so great. Well, after 7 years, they pulled out of doing liquor liability because they were so cheap and they couldn't keep up with the defense cost and all those sorts of things. So it's just an ongoing thing, you know, and at the end of the day, somebody's always going to come in. They're always going to, you know, want to do business at a price. And then, you know, how long do they last?
Right. So it's something to keep your eye on, or if something does like happen like that, you'll have an understanding. So like we try to get these little stories out there so that you're more informed as consumers and industry people who also listen, just so you know what's going on in the background and you know why, you know, if you're working for a brewery, why they might say, hey, all those samplings you have, we're going to pull off on that for a minute because we're changing carriers, or we're trying to understand what our liability is because something happened. That's where this is all going. I know, and we're not going to talk about it today. I know there was a liability trial case that went through the lower courts and went to the Supreme Court, and I think it got sent back to the lower courts because the court said that certain things should be considered. It hasn't been heard. It hasn't been picked up, but if that does get heard and it goes the direction we think it is, that would be a big win for, you know, some rationality on these issues. Just to give you a small piece, and I'll probably get Camila and you and maybe Pete Chelestre on here to talk about it because it's a little bit out there. But essentially, you know, the trial lawyers wanted to argue that they could hold a business for liable even if the person several days later was sober but maybe just tired. So that's the extent that they want to be able to take cases to trial. And if you win initially on the value on the merits of your case and they want to come back and say, you know what, we want to talk about how tired the client was because in a personal responsibility state, he overdid it, and now it's somehow this bar's fault. And we all know that people go from place to place. We all know they have things going on in their system. So that'll be a show we can do.
It's gonna be real interesting. I mean, the whole evaluation of personal responsibility just doesn't really exist in this state. And you know, I've had these fantasies of people that have to go out and drink need to carry $1 million of, you know, auto insurance. You know, that would just solve the problem and help the establishments, you know, that much more, because then this way they would go after the person who is personally responsible. Now, it would be different if you have video of somebody, you know, jamming beers down their throat over and over and the person pukes in the corner and you keep serving them. I get it. There's a liability issue there. But most of these cases I see are one or two drink cases where they were at establishment A and then they go to B, C, and D and all of them get pulled in because it's just good money for the people that make money doing that sort of thing.
Right on. So again, like these are things that affect your bars and your restaurants and you know, potentially going to affect, you know, your quality of life here on both sides. I mean, obviously we're not here to say, you know, businesses have no liability and people don't have liability. Right. But I think we're just looking for a balance and we're looking to make sure that our businesses are healthy to absorb any losses like that. If mistakes were made, that it's not a disqualifying event for that whole business.
Yes, you put that in great terms right there. And let's not make the mistake of thinking like, oh my God, we're not sympathetic people to the measures of what happens. Drunk driving is very serious. I mean, it's usually death, dismemberment. I mean, you know, all sorts of stuff that I have seen. You know, preliminary, pretty much on paper. And when you read through these claims and you hear what's happened and you see children dying and, you know, fathers and mothers and stuff like that. I had a mother that died that was jogging at 4 a.m. You know, this is really serious and it's very sad. And yes, I do feel that families should be compensated based on the actions of, you know, what had happened. But where is this compensation coming from? And, you know, who is really literally at fault and how, you know, how can we help the businesses at least survive, the brunt of the
sure.
liability?
I know you got an appointment. I'm going to ask two more questions here. I noticed my phone was ringing, your phone was ringing, but not to the extent of something really awful happening during the Super Bowl. So, I mean, kind of level. Did you have a good Super Bowl from that perspective of having most of your clients?
Yeah, okay. We had Bear Jackson, we had the Open, and we had the Super Bowl all, you know, with the crammed in a week, basically. Really 2 weeks, because we get a lot of people asking us for extension of premise and this and that. And you know what? Knock on wood. Of course, I don't usually see things until a year or 2 years after it's happened, mm-hmm. because that's the game they play. But knock on wood, so far, everything seemed to run really smooth. Everything was good. I mean, I read the paper, you know, or the online paper, and I didn't really see anything, you know, too detrimental. It feels like Arizona had a really good time.
Yeah. It's interesting you should mention it. I'm actually trying to get an extension of premise / special event for the end of beer week. And so I was down at the liquor department in the last couple of days.
That's right.
You know, we were running a legislation yesterday, so that went well. That was most of my Valentine's Day. I just wanted to point out if we don't get Andrew on the show, he's doing some things for the event coming up, that it was his 1 year anniversary on February 10th. So we sort of discussed it on our board call on our Valentine's Day call.
1 year. Yeah, wow. Congrats, Andrew.
Yeah. So, I wanted to ask you, I know you do not drink, yeah. But you are a fixture at all of our festivals. What do you see as, personally, what's your value in coming, and what do you see from a typical beer consumer, fan, curiosity seeker? What do you think their experience must be like?
Here's why I love the guild and the breweries and what they do. It's a niche market, kind of like what I've created. And I see a lot of similarities in myself and kind of what they're doing. I love the branding. I love the marketing. And most of all, as I had said in the beginning of the podcast, I love the sense of community. And the people that go there, they are literally there for the beer. They're there to check out new stuff, old stuff, things that they like, you know, meet with these amazing, you know, brewery, you know, employees and owners that are, you know, they're artists. At the end of the day, they're artists. And I really feel like, you know, when you go to a festival like this, you're enjoying good art, granted through your taste buds and maybe through your eyes in some cases. But yeah, that's what I really enjoy about it. I just love that. I love Arizona. I love everything about it. I love local business, and I just love the sense of community, and I love everything that the Guild has done to, you know, put this together as just a place for people to go and enjoy themselves, and there's always so much great feedback from it. And plus, I love the weather.
It's good to be outside. Last question. I was at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and I went to the tippy top, and there was three displays, and one of them was Eddie Van Halen describing his guitar and his method, and I sent you a picture.
Yeah.
Have you been to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
I haven't. We
should go sometime. I'm telling you, you'd love it. And I met the executive director there. We're executive director buds now. but I wanted to ask you. I'll tell you mine. What is your favorite Eddie Van Halen riff? Mine is Mean Streets. It's
Dude, that's mine. Just gonna blow. Yes, Mean Street. I just opened up an LLC for a side business I'm doing, and I named it Mean Street LLC.
All right, I'm gonna see if I can punch in that riff towards the end of the show. But great,
that's hilarious. Oh my god, I'll show you my corporate docs.
Right on, man.
Yeah, thanks for sending that picture. By the way, I was like, what is Rob sending me? I was like, oh my god, that is better than for me a naked woman. That guitar was everything.
I don't know if I want to be on the hook for that.
Except for my wife. Anyway.
What do they call that? A stick pick?
Stick pick.
Pick. Yeah. Pick. All right. Well, it was great talking to you, and we'll see you on Saturday.
Yeah. Thanks for having me.
If anyone's looking for Delo, he'll be wearing a strong beer coat and gill hat, or a strong beer hat. He will be, if you turn away, he'll be 50 yards away because he's got a lot of energy. So
yeah, and I'll have a camera out there too, and I'll probably want to talk to some of you. So
right on.
Well, fun.
Great.
Cool.
Great to talk to you, man.
You too, brother.